panel by setting the context for the panel. To do that, we would like to welcome two micro entrepreneurs. They shall share their entrepreneurship journey on how appropriate technology played a critical role in improving their businesses. To start with, Mr. Raghu Gulal. He's a talented potter from a community of potters in Alu, near Gulab. His passion towards pottery, enterprising attitude towards building the family tradition to a sustainable business, and appropriate solar energy interventions have made him one of the successful pottery entrepreneurs in the community. Raghu Gulab, please welcome on stage.
ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆ ಅಂತ ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಡಿಕೆ ಮಾಡುವಂಥ ಕೆಲಸ ನನ್ನ ತಂದೆಯವರು ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು. ಅದರ ನಂತರ
from the village of Alu near Kundapur. I've taken up the profession of pottery, which has come from my family. My dad was doing the pottery business, so I've taken up the same profession.
ನಂತರ ನನ್ನ ತಂದೆಯವರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರುವಾಗ ತುಂಬ ಕಷ್ಟಕರವಾದಂಥ ಕೆಲಸ. ಮಣ್ಣು ಮಾಡುವುದಾಗಲಿ, ಅದನ್ನು ಸುಡುವಂಥ ವಿಧಾನವಾಗಿರಲಿ, ಮತ್ತು ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೈಯಿಂದಲೇ ಕೆಲಸ ಆಗಬೇಕಾಗಿತ್ತು. ತಂದೆ ಮಾಡುವಂಥ ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನು ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ನಮಗೆ ತುಂಬ ಬೇಜಾರಾಗ್ತಿತ್ತು. ಆ ಕೆಲಸನೇ ಬೇಡ ಅಂತ ತುಂಬ ಬೇಜಾರವಾಗಿ ನಾವು ಶಾಲೆ 7ನೇ ತರಗತಿಯನ್ನು ಮುಗಿಸಿ ಹೋಟೆಲಿಗೆ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದೆ.
It's a very manual, there's a lot of drudgery involved in the process. So he grew up looking at his dad doing the process of pottery, be it baking, be it mixing. It involves a lot of drudgery and a lot of manual process. So that made him realize, okay, it's not for me. I'm not going to continue the profession. So after finishing his 7th, that's his primary school, he went to a smaller city to work in a hotel.
ಅದರ ನಂತರ ನನಗೆ ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆ ಕೆಲಸ ಅಂತೇಳಿದರೆ ಹೆಲ್ತಿ ಅಂತ, ತುಂಬ ಆರೋಗ್ಯಕರವಾದಂಥ ಮಡಿಕೆಗಳು, ಆದರೆ ಮಾಡೋರಿಗೆ ಮಾತ್ರ ಆರೋಗ್ಯವಾಗಿರಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಯಾಕಂತೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಅಷ್ಟು ಕಷ್ಟಕರವಾದಂಥ ಕೆಲಸ, ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೈಯಿಂದಲೇ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ಕೈಯಿಂದಲೇ ಮಿಕ್ಸಿಂಗ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ಮತ್ತು ಕಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಇದೆಲ್ಲವನ್ನು ದಾಸ್ತಾನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಹೊತ್ತುಕೊಂಡು ಹಳ್ಳಿ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಮಾರುಕಟ್ಟೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಮತ್ತು ತುಂಬ ಹಾರ್ಡಾಗಿ ನಾವು ದುಡಿಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ತುಂಬ ಗಂಟೆ, ಸಾಧಾರಣ ನಮ್ಮ ತಂದೆಯವರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರುವಾಗ 4 ಗಂಟೆ ರಾತ್ರಿ ತನಕ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು. ಮಾರುಕಟ್ಟೆಗೆ ಇದೆ, ಆದರೆ ಇವರು ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿರ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲ.
ಐ ಮೀನ್ ವಿ ಆಲ್ ಸೇ ಡ್ರಿಂಕಿಂಗ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಮಡ್ ಪಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಹೆಲ್ದಿ, ಹಿ ಸೇಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್, ಬಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಹೂ ವರ್ಕ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪಾಟ್ರಿ. ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಅನ್ಹೆಲ್ದಿ ಆಕ್ಯುಪೇಷನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಡ್ಯಾಡ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಅಟ್ ಸಮ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಟು ವರ್ಕ್ ಅಂಟಿಲ್ 4 o'clock ಟು ಈವನ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಫಿನಿಷಸ್ ಹಿಸ್ ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್, ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆಸ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ಇಟ್ ದ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ಸ್, ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್ಯುಲಿ. ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಟೇಕಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಟಾಲ್ ಆನ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್.
ನಮ್ಮ ತಂದೆ ತೀರ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದ ನಂತರ ನಾನು ಊರಿಗೆ ಬರಲೇಬೇಕಾಯಿತು. ನನ್ನ ಮನೆಯನ್ನು ನೋಡ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿ ನನಗೆ ಬಂತು. ಅದರ ನಂತರ CWC ನಮ್ಮ ಭೂಮಿ ಅನ್ನೋವಂಥ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಒಂದಿಷ್ಟು ನಮ್ಮವರನ್ನು ಗುರುತಿಸಿಕೊಂಡು ಇದನ್ನು ಮುಂದುವರಿಸಬೇಕು, ಪಾರಂಪರಿಕವಾಗಿ ಅಲ್ಲದೆ ಕಲಾತ್ಮಕವಾಗಿ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ಹೊರಗಡೆ ಮಾರುಕಟ್ಟೆಯನ್ನು ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಭಿವೃದ್ಧಿಗೋಸ್ಕರ ಅವರು ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಒಂದು ಜೀನನಂತ ಅವರು ತರಬೇತಿಗೆ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಒಳಪಡಿಸಿದರು.
So after his dad died, he had to come back to his village from the hotel work he was doing. But when he came back, he was fortunate to have an interaction with an institute called Namma Bhumi. It's an institute, a training institute near his village. And there they trained a local, the traditional and local artisanal occupation training, because that institution, along with some of the community members there, they try to keep the traditions alive. I mean, these traditions have a history of more than, I mean, thousands of years old. So they want to keep the tradition alive. And he was fortunate to actually meet the institute.
ತರಬೇತಿಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರುವಾಗ ತುಂಬ ಖುಷಿ ಆಯಿತು. ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಬದಲಾಗುವಂಥ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಯನ್ನು ಕಂಡು ಬಂದಿತ್ತು ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಅದರ ನಂತರ ದೆಹಲಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು 2 ತಿಂಗಳು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ತರಬೇತಿಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದೆ. ನಿಫ್ಟ್ ಅಂತ, ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ಯಾಸನ್ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ ಅಂತ. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗಲೂ ಕೂಡ ನಾವು ಇನ್ನೂ ಬದಲಾಗಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ.
So after the training in Kundapur, he went to Delhi to National Institute of Fashion Technology and left to further to actually enhance his training skills. So he says, it's a combination of his the art has come from his hereditary and now combining with the new technology and modern mechanisms, he actually improved his skills as well.
ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗಿದೆ, ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮ ಸ್ಥಿತಿಯನ್ನು ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗಿದೆ ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ಊರಿಗೆ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೀವಿ. ಊರಿಗೆ ಬಂದ ಮೇಲೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ವಾಪಸ್ ನಾವು ಅದೇ ಸ್ಥಿತಿಯಲ್ಲೇ ಇರಬೇಕಾಯಿತು.
I mean, there was hope. They went to Delhi, they saw a lot of things, but when they came back, the situation was not better. Anyway, it was four of them actually went there thinking they would have a better life, and they come back, but the situation wasn't any different.
ಅದರ ನಂತರ ನಾವು ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನು ಮುಂದಿಸ್ತಾ ಹೋದಾಗ ಒಂದು ಎರಡು ಮೂರು ವರ್ಷ ನನ್ನ ಜೊತೆ ಇದ್ದವರೆಲ್ಲ ಹೋದರು, ಅವರು ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನು ಹುಡ್ಕೊಂತ ಹೋದ್ರು. ನನಗೆ ಮನೆ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಹೋಗ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಒಂದು ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಅದೇ. ಮನೆ ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಹೋಗದೆ ಇರೋದೇ ಕಾರಣದಿಂದ ನಾನು ಅದನ್ನೇ ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದೆ.
So other three people left the village again, the same story. They went back, but he didn't leave home because he was the only one to take care of his family, so he had to be there and continue his profession of pottery in his village.
Martha iruvaga kalaatmaka vastugalu jothege ಪಾರಂಪರಿಕವಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟನ್ನು ಮಾಡೋಣ, ಅಂದರೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಊರು ಕಡೆಯೇ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಸೇಲ್ ಆಗ್ಬೋದಂತ ಪಾರಂಪರಿಕವಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದೆ. ಟೀ ಕಪ್ಪು, ಜ್ಯೂಸ್ ಕಪ್ಪು, ಮೊಸರು ಮಡಿಕೆ ಇತ್ಯಾದಿಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಕಲಾತ್ಮಕ ವಸ್ತುಗಳು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಹೋದಾಗ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, ತುಂಬ ನಾವು ಶ್ರಮ ಪಡಬೇಕು, ತುಂಬ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದನ್ನು ಮಾರುಕಟ್ಟೆ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಿದ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಸಿಟಿ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಬರಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ಆ ಉದ್ದೇಶವನ್ನು ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಇದನ್ನು ನಾನು ಗುರಿ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೆ.
So he knew there was a market existing for a lot of things. I mean, the coffee mugs, the water containers, there were things, but because he had a traditional background as well as the skills that he understood from his training, he started making those the pottery creations using those skills. But the market was there, but he was not able to cater to it.
ನನ್ನ ಮತ್ತೆ ಬದಲಾವಣೆಯ ಕಾರಣ ನಮ್ಮ ಭೂಮಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಅಂಗಡಿ ಅಂತ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟ್ ಸಪ್ಲೈ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೆ. ಅದೊಂದು ನನ್ನ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಉಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕಾಯಿತು. ಅದ್ರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಪಿಲಿಕುಳ, ಮಂಗಳೂರು ಪಿಲಿಕುಳ ನಿಸರ್ಗಧಾಮದವರು, ಅವರು ಕೂಡ ಕೆಲವು ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ನನಗೆ ಟ್ರೈನರ್ ಆಗಿ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ರು. ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನನಗೆ ಮತ್ತಿಷ್ಟು ಗಟ್ಟಿಯಾಗಿ ಉಳಿಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯತೆ ಆಯಿತು ಆ ಕೆಲಸದಿಂದ.
He got markets through again the training institute which was there. It provided the market for his products as well as another place in Mangalore where they actually contacted him and he could sell his products there as well.
ಅದರ ನಂತರ ನಮಗೆ ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಪೋಲಿಸಿನಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮ ಮೋಟರ್ ಇದೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಮೊದಲು ಕೈಯಲ್ಲಿ ತಿರುಗುವಂತ ಚಕ್ರ ಇದ್ದಿತ್ತು. ಆ ಶ್ರಮ ಒಂದು ದಿನಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು 100 ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಿದ್ರೆ ಚಿಕ್ಕದಾದ್ರೂ ಕೂಡ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು 400 ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ. ಇವರು ನಮ್ಮ ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನಿಂದ ಬಂದು ಅದನ್ನ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹೇಗೆ ಹೇಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಂತ ಅವರು ಕಡೆಯವರೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು. ಅವರ ನೆನಪುಗಳು ನಾನು ಅದು ಜಾಸ್ತಿಯಾಗಿ ಇದು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೆ. ಯಾಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾರೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂತ ನನಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿದ್ದಿಲ್ಲ.
ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಇಕೋಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್. ಸೊ ಹಿ ನ್ಯೂ ದ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್, ದ ಸ್ಕಿಲ್ ವಾಸ್ ದೇರ್, ಬಟ್ ದೇರ್ ವಾಸ್ ನೋ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ ದಟ್ ಕುಡ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಮೇಕ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಕೇಟರ್ ಟು ದ ಡಿಮ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ವಾಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್. ಸೊ ದಟ್ಸ್ ವೆನ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ದ ಸೋಲಾರ್ ಪವರ್ ಪಾಟ್ರಿ ಮೆಷಿನ್ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಪಾಟ್ರಿ ಮೆಷಿನ್ ವಾಸ್ ಇಂಟರ್ವೀನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ದೆಮ್. ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಮೇಕಿಂಗ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 50 to 100 those curves or those creations earlier, but through this now he can make more than 400. He can make around 400 which he knew the market was existing earlier.
ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಪೌಂಡೇಶನಿಂದ ಬರುವಾಗ ನನಗೆ ಒಂದು ವೀಲು ನಿಮಗೆ ಇಡ್ತೀವಿ ನಾವು ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಟೈಮು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರು. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಆಯಿತು ಒಪ್ಕೊಂಡೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದೆ. ಅದ್ರ ನಂತರ ನಮ್ಮ ಗುರುಪ್ರಕಾಶ್ ಸರ್ ಬಂದು ಏನೇನು ಮಾಹಿತಿಗಳನ್ನು ಕಲೆಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು, ಹೇಗೆ ಯಾವ್ಯಾವ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಕೆಲಸದಲ್ಲಿ ಹೇಗೆ ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ಮುಂದೆ ನಡ್ಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನೋಂಥ ಮಾಹಿತಿಯನ್ನು ಅವ್ರು ಪಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ರು.
One of the important aspects is the need assessment. So he tells when the intervention happened, it just didn't happen in such a way that they came and installed the machine and they went back. So they came and they actually asked him what was the need, what was the right, like appropriate need that he had, and what machine or what solar design could actually help him help him making to cater to his needs. And one point I forgot, that one he mentioned earlier, was it especially if you're catering to better markets, like if you're selling in Mangalore, they need the fitness in the product, and doing it manually, it takes a lot of time. The drudgery involved is very high, so the intervention, the technological intervention, was very much necessary along with the right need assessment.
ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಅವರು ಮಿಕ್ಸಿಂಗು ಬ್ಲೆಂಜರ್ ಅಂತ, ಮತ್ತು ಬಕ್ಮೆಲ್ಲು, ಮತ್ತು ಇದು ಕಿಲ್ಲು ಸುಡೋ ಬಟ್ಟಿಯನ್ನು, ಅದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ನಮಗೆ ಮಾಡಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ರು. ಅದ ನಂತರ ಸೋಲಾರ್ ಬಂದಾಗ ನನ್ನ ಜೀವನದ ಒಂದು ಬೆಳಕು ಬಂತು ನನಗೆ. ಯಾಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಕತ್ತಲಲ್ಲೇ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡುವಂಥದ್ದು, ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ನನಗೆ ಇರುವಂಥ ಜಾಗನೂ ಕೂಡ ತುಂಬ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಗಿತ್ತು. ಡಿಸ್ಪ್ಲೇ ಮಾಡಿ ಜಾಗನೂ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೆ, ಮತ್ತು ಎಕ್ಸಿಬಿಷನ್ ರೂಮ್ ಮಾಡಿಸಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ರು. ಇವಾಗ ಅದನ್ನು ತುಂಬ ಬದಲಾವಣೆ ಆಗಿ ಕಂಡು ಬಂತು.
So it involves a lot of factors. It's not just the pottery wheel that has to be empowered with solar. He has to mix the soil, then it has to be baked. So the intervention, the right interventions happen in every stage, from mixing the soil till baking till actually making the cups. And he didn't stop there. So he says, the place where he sells the products is not just the outside markets. He has a very well-designed store right next to his pottery making place. So the people, when they come there, they actually could see his products over there and they can buy it and then take away. So he tells, solar energy literally actually brought light in his life.
Solar in the yalla salakarane bandhanantra, naan yochane maadde, nanige ondu naalku jana kelasadavaru alli ready aadranta. Naalku janaranna ನನಗೆ ರೆಡಿಯಾಗಿ ಕೆಲಸದವರು ಆಗಿದ್ದರು. ಇನ್ನು ಕೆಲಸದವರು ಇಲ್ದಿದ್ರು ಕೂಡ ನಾನು ಮಾಡಬಹುದು, ಮುಂದುವರ್ಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗ್ಬೋದು. ಅದರ ನಂತರ ಕೂಡ ಇನ್ನೂ 4 ಜನ ಕೆಲಸದವರು ಕೂಡ ಬಂದಿದ್ದರು, ಒಟ್ಟು 8 ಜನ ಕೆಲಸದವ್ರ ಥರ ಆಗಿದೆ ನನಗೆ. ಇವಾಗ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪನಲ್ಲ, ತುಂಬಾ ನನಗೆ ನನಗಿಂತಲೂ ಎತ್ತರವಾಗಿ ನನ್ನ ವರ್ಕ್ಶಾಪ್ ನಡೆಸಿದೆ.
ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ದ ಸೈಕಲ್. To complete the cycle, he started alone, but today he has given employment. He started with 4 people. Now 8 people actually run the entire production unit, and he tells it's grown beyond like what I am today. It's grown beyond what he had like imagined that would grow one day.
Kumbarike ante helidre kumbarike ond 9 tingalu tanaka kelsa adanantara madagala banta helidre ondu ಕೆಲಸ ಸ್ಟಾಪ್, ಮತ್ತು 3 ತಿಂಗಳು ಬೇರೆ ಕೆಲಸಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು ಎಲ್ಲ ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆಯ ಕೆಲಸದವರು. ಹಾಗೆ ಇವಾಗ ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಕಂಡೀಷನಿಂದ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನ ಬದಲಾವಣೆಯನ್ನು ಕಂಡು ಬಂದಿತ್ತು, ಅದೇ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮಳೆಗಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ನಾನು ನನ್ನ ವರ್ಕರ್ಸ್ ಜೊತೆ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಮಳೆಗಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ನನ್ನ ಕೆಲಸ ಸ್ಟಾಪ್ ಇರುವುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂ ನನ್ನ ಕೆಲಸಗಳು ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ನಡೀತಿದೆ.
So the traditional pottery works only 9 months a year. In the monsoon, they have to stop it. But due to the technology intervention, now he could work the entire year. So, you understand, it gives him more market access and income generation as well.
ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಗುರುತಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಪ್ರಕಾರವಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಲೋನ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗಿದ್ದೆ. ನಿಮಗೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಮಡಿಕೆ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಒಂದಿಷ್ಟು ಮಣ್ಣು ಮತ್ತೆ ಕಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಇದ್ರೆ ಸಾಕಲ್ಲ, ಇಷ್ಟೆಲ್ಲ ಪ್ರಾಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಹೇಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ತೀರಾ, ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಇದ್ದೀರಿ ನೀವು? ನಿಜವಾಗಲೂ ನಮಗೆ ಬೇಕಾಗುವಂಥ ಜಾಗಗಳು ಮತ್ತು ಸವಲತ್ತುಗಳು ತುಂಬಾ ಬೇಕಾಗತ್ತೆ. ಅದು ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಇವತ್ತು ಮಡಿಕೆ ಮಾಡೋರು 20 ರೂಪಾಯಿಗೆ 30 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಮಡಿಕೆ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಅವರು ತುಂಬ 60-70 ಏಜಿನವರು, ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಕೆಳಗಿನ ಅಂತ ಕೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಒಬ್ಬನೇ, ನನಗಿಂತ ಕೆಳಗಿನವರು ಮತ್ತಿನ್ನು ಬರಬೇಕಷ್ಟೇ. ನನಗಿಂತ 60-70 ವರ್ಷ ನಮ್ಮ ಊರಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅವರು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ.
He also touched upon the finance. If they go to the bank people will say, all you need is just a pot of soil and some place to work. Why do you need even financing to make pottery? And also, one of the things he's very concerned is in his community, except him, rest are all in their 60s and 70s or older. So no one is taking up the job. So he's just concerned about the whole tradition actually going away from the people.
ವಿದ್ಯಾಭ್ಯಾಸವಾದವರು, ಬಿ ಕಾಮು, SSC, PUC ಎಲ್ಲ ಆಗಿರೋರು ಈಗ ನನ್ನ ಜೊತೆ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಒಂದು ಖುಷಿ. ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದರೆ ಪರಂಪರೆಯೇ ನಸಿದು ಹೋಗುವಂಥ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆಯ ಜೀವನದಲ್ಲಿ ಬೆಳಕಾಗಿ ಬಂದಿರುವುದು ತುಂಬ ಖುಷಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ.
It's very proud to tell that people who are working with him, they're all very well educated. They have done their undergrad, they've done their the studies in economics and commerce, but they are working with him in pottery. So he hopes, due to the right intervention, that his tradition could be safe for the future generations.
ಇವಾಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ಮಡಿಕೆ ಸಾಧನ ಒಂದು 10-15 ವರ್ಷದ ಈಚೆ ಮಡಿಕೆನೆ ನಾವು ಕೂಡ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಿರ್ಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಪಾತ್ರೆಗಳು ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಒಂದು 4-5 ವರ್ಷದ ಈಚೆ ಹೆಲ್ತಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಿದ್ರು, ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಿದ್ರು. ನಾವು ಚಿಕ್ಕವರಿರುವಾಗ ಅದರಿಂದ ಅಡುಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಿಂತಿದ್ವಿ. ಇವಾಗ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ 4-5 ವರ್ಷದ ಈಚೆ ನಾವು ನಾನು ಹೇಳಿದೆ, ನಾವು ಕೂಡ ಬದಲಾಗೋಣ, ನಾವು ಕೂಡ ಇದರಿಂದ ನೋಡೋಣ ಅಂತ. ನಿಜವಾಗ್ಲೂ ಪ್ಲಾಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಕು ಅಲ್ಯೂಮಿನಿಯಂ ಬೇರೆ ಪಾತ್ರೆಗಿಂತ ಈ ಬೇಸಿಗೆ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂಡ ಮಡಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಅಡುಗೆಗಳು ತುಂಬ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿರುತ್ತೆ, ಮತ್ತು ಬೂಸ್ಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಏನು ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಇರೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಹಾಳು ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಜನ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ತುಂಬ. ಈಗ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟಿಂಗ್ ಇದೆ, ಮಡಿಕೆಗೂ ಸಹಿತ ತುಂಬ ಮಾರುಕಟ್ಟೆ ಇದೆ. ಜನ ಕೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಒಡೆದೋಗುತ್ತೆ ಅಂತ. ಇವು ಅವರಿಗೆ 20-30 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಹಣ ನೋಡ್ತಾರೆ ಬಿಟ್ಟರೆ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಸ್ವಚ್ಛ ಭಾರತ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಸ್ವಚ್ಛ ಭಾರತ ಹೇಗಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ನನ್ನ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ.
So the benefits are not just income generation. What it tells us, because he picked up the whole pottery thing for like last few years, his and his family decided that okay, we'll stop using plastic items or any other materials at home, and we'll start using the everything that's made out of the mud and prepared by their family itself. And he sees the difference. So he also tells, I mean, people talk about keeping the country clean, the Swachh Bharat mission and everything, but they are concerned about paying 30 rupees for a pot with the reason saying, oh, it's very brittle, if I let it fall down it'll break. But that's not the reason. So he tells, if you're really concerned about your health and your traditions as well as environment, I mean, going ahead with the
madike odadu hogidru kuda ನಮ್ಮ ಆರೋಗ್ಯವನ್ನು ಹಾಳು ಮಾಡಿ ಹೋಗುವುದಿಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಮಾತ್ರ ಹೋಗುತ್ತೆ, ಮತ್ತು ಮಾಡೋರು ಇರ್ತಾರೆ. ಹಾಗಾಗಿ ಅದು ಒಡೆದ್ರೂ ಕೂಡ ನಮ್ಮ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಹಾಳು ಮಾಡದೇ ಇರೋ ಕಾರಣದಿಂದ ಅದನ್ನು ಬಳಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳೋದೇ ಒಳ್ಳೆಯದು. ಯಾಕಂದರೆ ನಾನು ಮಾಡಿದರೆ, ಮಡಿಕೆ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ನನ್ನ ಜೀವನಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಒಂದು 100 ಜನರಿಗೆ ಕೊಡ್ಬೋದು. ಈ ಕೋಟಿ ಜನರಿಗೆ ನನಗೆ ಸಪ್ಲೈ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ನನ್ನ ಉದ್ದೇಶ ಇಷ್ಟೇ, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಆರೋಗ್ಯವಾಗಿರಬೇಕಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಒಬ್ಬನಿಂದ ಪೂರೈಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಕೋಟಿ ಜನರಲ್ಲೇ 100,000 ಜನ ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ಮಾತ್ರ ಪೂರೈಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗ್ಬೋದೇನೋ ಅದು ನಾನು ಹೇಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಆದರೂ ಕೂಡ ಈ ಒಡೆದು ಹೋಗುವಂಥ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಏನು ಇರುವುದಿಲ್ಲ.
So he says a pot might break, but if you really are concerned about it, I mean concerned about health of the entire nation or the crores of people, because he could cater to 100 or probably 1,000 people, but if the whole tradition or even the healthy generation has to sustain for future, so he tells more people have to pick up the traditional art of pottery, and he hopes through the right interventions it will happen.
Plastic, aluminium, steel, beku ilde adu prapanchadalli enu illa yakanta helidre adu adru jothege ee madikigalu kuda nimma jothege idrene maatra adu ondu olleya ಪರಿಸರ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರಕೃತಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ಮಡಿಕೆ ನನ್ನ ಅನುಭವ ಬಂದಿದ್ದು ನನ್ನ 4-5 ವರ್ಷದ ಈಚೆ ಮಡಿಕೆ ಈ ಥರನೆಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ, ಈ ಥರ ಆರೋಗ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಇರ್ತಿದೆ ಅಂತ ನನಗೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿದ್ದಿಲ್ಲ. ನಾನು ಕುಂಬಾರನಾಗಿ ಕೂಡ ನನಗೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಮತ್ತು ಇತ್ತೀಚಿನ ದಿನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಕುಂಬಾರನ ಅನ್ಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೂ ಖುಷಿ ಪಡ್ತಿದ್ದೆ. ಮೊದಲು ಕುಂಬಾರ ಅನ್ಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೂ ಕೂಡ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಕುಲಾಲ ಅನ್ಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕು ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಅನಿಸಿದ್ರು, ಈಗ ನಾನು ಕುಂಬಾರ ಅನ್ಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಖುಷಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ.
So he's very proud to be called as a potter. So in his last name is Kulal, but in Kannada there's a tradition that their occupation is called his last name as well. Now if people call him Kumbar is the Kannada word for potter, and he's very proud when people call him a potter instead of his name. So
ee kumbarike kelasidinda nanu tumba kade hogide, yakandre Delhi agli Bangalore tumba kade bandide nanu, Malleshwaram Vikas Sauda ಮತ್ತು ಮಲ್ಲೇಶ್ವರಂ ಇಂಥ ಕಡೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ತುಂಬ ಎಕ್ಸಿಮಿಷನ್ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮಿಗೆಲ್ಲ ಬಂದಿದೆ. ಕಾರಣ ನನ್ನ ಈ ಕೆಲಸ ಮತ್ತು ಕುಂಬಾರಿಕೆಯೇ ಕಾರಣ ಆಗಿತ್ತು. ನಾನು ಕಾರಣ ಆಗಿರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಮತ್ತು CWC ಮತ್ತು ಸೆಲ್ಕೋ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ಗೆ ನನ್ನ ಕೃತಜ್ಞತೆಗಳು ಶಾಶ್ವತವಾದಂಥ.
So it's very thankful for the intervention. Because of that he's actually got a platform to share his thoughts, and so that more people will be inspired from his story. Thank you.
ಒಂದು ತುಮಕೂರು ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟ್ ಪೋಷಕರ ಪಾಂಡೆ ಗ್ರಾಮದಿಂದ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೀನಿ. ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಹಗ್ಗ ತಯಾರು ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವು, ಸಾರ್ಬೇಕ ಅದು ಒಂದು ಮೂರು ಜನ ನಾಲ್ಕು ಜನ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು, ಇವಾಗ ಇಬ್ಬರೇ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಒಂದು ಹತ್ಬಂಡು ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಉದ್ದಾರ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರು, ಇವಾಗ ಇದರಿಂದ ಇಪ್ಪತ್ತು ಬಂಡು ಬಿತ್ತೀನಿ. ಒಂದು ದಿನಕ್ಕೆ ನಾಲ್ಕು ಸಾವಿರ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ, ಒಂದು ಬರೀ ಒಂದೂವರೆ ಸಾವಿರ ಮಾತ್ರ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು.
So he used to, he does rope making machine. And so how it happens is the choir that comes out of coconut. So he uses that to make ropes. And earlier he had a manual machine through which he could make 10 bundles. Like a bundle is a bunch of those ropes. And now he could actually double
his production. And now, earlier he used to make 1,500 rupees a month. Now it's gone to 4,000 rupees. Per day.
ಇವಾಗ ಮೊದಲು ತುಂಬಾನೇ ಸೌಂಡ್ ಬರ್ತಿತ್ತು, ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಕ್ ಆಗ್ತಿರಲ್ಲ. ಇವಾಗ ಸೌಂಡ್ ತುಂಬಾ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಸೌಂಡೇ ಬರಲ್ಲ, ಆರಾಮಾಗಿ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು.
And also it reduced the manual machine had a lot of sound, so that the right technology has actually made this process very smooth and silent.
ಮೊದಲು 4 ಜನ 5 ಜನ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದು, ಇವಾಗ ಇಬ್ಬರೇ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಅಂದ್ರೆ ನೈಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡಬಹುದು, ಲೈಟಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹಾಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ತುಂಬಾ ಅನುಕೂಲ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಇವಾಗ
earlier it involved many people and relying on many people for to come and actually work, but now he could manage with just a couple of people, and most importantly he can actually work in the nights as well. So the solution also had a solar lighting solution through which he can work in the nights as well.
To build upon the context set by our two entrepreneurs, we have a set of panelists from technology enterprises and people in the Impact Fund ecosystem and incubation. Firstly, we have Smita Rakesh, who looks after implementing impact measures, portfolio optimization strategies at Foundation for Innovation and Social Entrepreneurship. Welcome, Smita, on stage. Secondly, we would like to welcome Shubhoday Ganta, who is an Associate Vice President in Power and Utilities Group at Ernst & Young. His experience varies from advising governments to non-profit organizations in the areas of clean energy technology, policy and investment. Welcome, Shubhoday. Next, we have Karthik Chandrasekhar, who is the founder and CEO of Sangam Ventures, which focuses on early stage funding of enterprises working towards resource productivity and fighting climate change. He's very well versed with the clean technology enterprise ecosystem in India. Please welcome Karthik.
Next, as panelists, we would like to call Kusumadhara Kapalakaje, who's the managing director of Shira Enterprise. Shira Enterprise, a milking machine manufacturing company, carrying on the responsibility of technology and business development for the milking machine that was invented by his father-in-law. Today, Shira caters to various countries across the globe and have sold more than 10,000 milking machines. Please welcome Kusumadhara. Up next, we have R. Narayan, a mechanical engineer whose passion for building efficient agricultural technologies has made him combine his research and development experience, translating into impacting the farming sector through his enterprise, Big Stamps Agri-Processing Machines. Please welcome Narayan. Now we have Shailaja Vittal, an agri-tech entrepreneur who left her IT profession to pursue manufacturing reliable and affordable agriculture and horticulture machinery. Recipient of many national awards for her contribution towards agri-automation innovation, she is a mentor for several women universities across India. Please welcome Shailaja. Finally, to moderate the event, I'd like to call upon Rachita from Selco Foundation, who will take the discussion from here.
sir and Jagdish sir for telling us your stories. I have my eye on the clock, so we'll start right away. So we have a panel here which is a mix of tech entrepreneurs themselves as well as incubation, specifically to discuss how do we actually encourage more innovations that can help entrepreneurs like Raghu sir and like Jagdish sir. So to start off, I'll start off with you, Shibode. In terms of you from EY, you know, did a study recently to identify the opportunities in energy efficiency, the market space in general. Could you maybe just briefly tell us one or two key opportunities and also highlight how are you planning to take the study forward from here on?
Thanks, Rachita. So with the support of Shakti Sustainable Energy Foundation, we have been exploring a diverse set of, you know, both consumptive and productive livelihood applications, especially to, you know, pilot scalable energy access interventions that effectively integrate energy efficient technologies and designs. So in this effort, another secondary objective of this effort was also to pilot interventions which are flexible. That is, we wanted to pilot and scale up energy efficient technologies which are interoperable between the distributed renewable energy systems and the central grid. We believe that this interoperability gives the flexibility for consumers to run their appliances both in the grid condition and with the DRE system. So this was another secondary objective. In this effort, we have interacted with a wide variety of stakeholders, which included, you know, the DRE system integrators, the service providers. And during our interactions, one of the key takeaways which we, you know, got is that it is very difficult to source energy efficient products from the market. I guess this is why we are here today, to discuss what are these challenges for the manufacturers to develop and scale energy efficient products for the market. Now, before I start off telling what are these challenges from our point of view, what we gathered, let's first understand what are the opportunities for energy efficiency in today's scenario. So if you see any mechanized rural livelihood application, you can broadly, you know, break it into five components. One is the energy supply system, then there is a motor, its control system, the mechanical transmission part, and the basic driven equipment part. Now, where is the opportunity for the energy efficiency? The lowest hanging fruit for energy efficiency opportunities comes from the motors and the control systems. Now, there are technologies today which has built advancements in permanent magnet motors has led to technologies such as brushless DC motors and, you know, permanent magnet synchronous motors, which were earlier used in space and defense applications. Now they are being increasingly used for household appliances. Now, what is important is that there is a great need to step up innovation from the manufacturers to test, to integrate these technologies, these motor technologies, into their existing equipment. So they need to test for each of these technologies in their existing equipment design and see the applicability of that technology into different end-use applications. Now, the applicability again depends on the end-use applications, you know, low torque characteristics, speed torque curves, and all of this. So you'll have to evaluate and best match this, okay? This is the greatest need today, and this is the lowest hanging fruit, because these technologies are quite mature, advanced, and they're already available. And a lot of components of these technologies are already indigenized as well. Now, when we move to the equipment part, which is the other important innovation area, in the equipment side, what is important is, you know, the process. There is a lot of scope for innovation in the process, how the equipment is designed. There's a lot of scope for innovation in the materials used for that equipment manufacturing. So materials which can change phases, thermal properties, all of these are important. So there's a lot of innovation which is possible and to improve energy efficiency on the equipment side. Now, in terms of the scale of the market, if you see, I believe recently CEW did a study and they sized the market for energy efficient products alone, and that is only in 14 non-farming based livelihood applications, that's $5 billion. This is the scale of the market size for energy efficiency products. Now, knowing these opportunities, what are the challenges for, you know, developing and scaling these energy efficient products, which we believe from our interactions for the manufacturers? Now, it is important that the manufacturers and the ecosystem see these challenges across the life cycle of the product development and commercialization. So if you see from the concept to prototype stage, that is where you build the prototypes by integrating, one of the biggest challenges is the lack of infrastructure and early grant support. When I say infrastructure, it is something like, you know, fabrication labs or the facilities where you can build these types, okay? So there is a great need for collaboration between academia and the manufacturers to bridge these gaps. And enterprises like Social Alpha or anyone, this is where they have to invest their capital. This is where an early grant support is required for manufacturers to build these prototypes which can integrate these technologies. Now, the next stage is the crucial stage where you go from prototype to pilot, okay? So this stage is termed usually by World Bank as the Valley of Death because this is the highest risky stage. In this stage, one of the important barriers faced by the manufacturers is developing a cost-effective value chain for your product. When I say cost-effective value chain, since the rural market is very competitive and, you know, price sensitive, you need to have a very cost-effective manufacturing, distribution, retail, and after-sales service. You need to build this with the advanced technologies. So this can be one of the challenges. The second challenge is you need to have that strategic support to pilot. Why this stage is very important, that is prototype to pilot, is in this stage you pilot your product and you get the important customer feedback, insights to improve your product, mainstream, you know, streamline your business models. So this strategic support is very important at this stage to pilot the product. That's where engagements such as ours, Shakti engagement. Now what we are looking for is, you know, we are looking for market ready products to help them, you know, scale up, test them with the support of governments or, you know, demand aggregation with the help of DRE system aggregators or even DISCOMs and all that. So that's where we are trying to do here. Another important aspect here is, the next stage, which is the pilot to commercialization stage, okay? Now in this stage, the most important thing is the scale for the manufacturer. So once you've tested your product, you got your, you know, feedback, important feedback, how to improve your business model, how to improve your product, you need the scale, economies of scale to be competitive and also supply your product to the market. So this is very important. This is where, again, we come in to help the manufacturers or even the suppliers. We work with DISCOMs and we work with a lot of agencies. We try to aggregate demand for this product and we structure those programs and we do, you know, bulk, we help DISCOMs do the bulk procurement for these products. But I'm seeing today, even in the outside, a lot of products are still using PMDC motors, that is permanent magnet DC motors. I've been told some of the products have been tested with BLDC motors, but what I believe is there is a great need for stepping up innovation in these areas. So we need to have more number of innovation challenges focusing on rural livelihood applications which can bring about energy efficient technologies, test these energy efficient technologies.
So the other thing was also, like, as you rightly pointed out, there are loads of technologies that, you know, have a potential of being used, you know, actually in these kind of applications, which can spur livelihood activities. But also, as you know, one of the things that Raghu sir was also speaking about very modestly was how he partnered with us to actually tell us what the need was.
Correct.
So that need assessment becomes super important. Now here, I'll come to Kusumdhara sir, because very unique case in terms of coming from this whole background of dairy farming. Father-in-law was a dairy farmer, actually was struggling with, you know, milking every day, recognized the innovation, the power of innovation, complemented by a sir here who had the engineering skills, knew how to solve that issue, and then kind of scaled it on from there on. So Kusumdhara sir, if you could elaborate on that journey a bit more, on how did you work from turning your innovation or turning your father-in-law and your innovation into an enterprise which is now looking at supplying, you know, milking machines across the country and otherwise as well.
Yeah, my father-in-law Raga Gowda was a primary school teacher initially. He had a small dairy farm and has got a small agriculture in arecanut farming also. So on his time, from morning, from 6 to 9, he used to do dairy work in his dairy and then go to school. The problem started when he was having problem with the labor and he was not able to milk his animal during that time. And so that's where he was thinking of buying a milking machine. I think in 2002, the milking machine what he inquired costed about 90,000 rupees. That is in 2002. So he could not afford that. So he was thinking of a idea how to milk this. So that is where he is recognized as an innovator. All of you might have seen the gutter pump used to spray pesticides in the farm. He took that pump and started adapting onto the animal teats, and he was able to suck the milk actually. So that is the invention. It is the idea, main idea, what is the behind this enterprise now. So that gutter pump idea came, and we are able to start run this enterprise now. So initially he was able to milk, but the problem was with the technique. It was not a technique which should be used for milking. He was just pumping the milk directly from the teats. It was not good for animal. Then he came to me. I was an engineer. I was working in a multinational company called Caterpillar. I think in 2002 we started working on this. I suggested him the technology to develop. So since we are working on the same family, it was very easy for us to communicate each other, innovator and the engineer. So we were able to develop this product very nicely. We started with hand operated machine. The basic idea was to move away from power electricity, and we used to have that gutter pump system itself, and we used to operate through hand. That was good for milking about 5 animals or maybe maximum up to 10 animals in 1 hour time. You know, this milking has to be completed within 1 hour time, and it has to be moved to the collecting center, otherwise it will get spoiled. With that machine, they could milk about 10 animals in 1 hour. And then that need came from the farmers who had higher animals in the towns. The people who had more than 8 animals, they wanted to have electrical machines. They inquired us. We thought of trading the machines which were available in the market. We started to analyze on trading actually, but at that time I thought we should be not doing that, because our machine can be more efficient than what is available in the market, because the market available machines were running from a vacuum pump, which is a rotary pump, which is not so efficient as the technique what we are using, which is a reciprocating pump. So we use a reciprocating pump, and that is more efficient than rotary pump, which is which were adopted by other manufacturers. So I used AC motor, which is about 120 watt powered, compared to the one which was used in the market, which was using 1 HP, that is about 745 watts. So in that sense, our machine was more efficient, and we are able to run the machine through inverter. If the power was not there, we are able to run the machine with the inverter. But then the problem is with the village side, where even power connections were not there. So we offered machines with the battery, which can be charged from a tractor, or whenever they can go to a nearby shop and get the battery charged and run for 5 days, like that. But the problem with the charger was they were not efficient. There were technical problems. Electronic instruments they need service support, which we could not provide because our network was not so good. Then in 2009 we dropped these machines, and it's a rebirth from solar for actually our battery machines. In 2016, Mr. Kishore from Selco started researching on this again, and he came to us, and we are offering this battery operated milking machines. Actually, we use PMDC motors, which is powered 120 watt powered for this. We have milking 2 animals at a time, that is powered at about 150 watts. And coming to this enterprise, we wanted to start this business at our village only. Our village is about 300 kilometers from this Bangalore. and there is, it's absolute, there is no technicians available in the village. Everyone might have moved to Bangalore or Bombay for seeking the job. No one is there. You can see all our villages are the only old people remain in the villages. Elders are seeking jobs and moving out. So we thought we should start the enterprise here in our village itself, because if we go to Bangalore or Hassan to starting an enterprise, once again we will not be able to bring the people who left our village here back to the village. So in this contest we started the business, the enterprise at our village itself. Initially it was very difficult. I was working in Bangalore. I was sourcing all the components. I was designing all these components for them. And my father-in-law was working as a technician himself. He worked day and night. He was assembling the machine. I know initial 25 machines were assembled by him, and he himself carried and sold them. So it was in 2002 to 2005. And luckily we are lucky enough to be recognized by National Innovation Foundation, which gave us a boost. Late Mr. Sahasranam and along with Vittal, Vijay Vittal, he's here, he was working in NIF. They recognized us. They came to our house. They shot this invention, and there was a publicity for this. And National Innovation Foundation awarded my father-in-law with the state award during 2005 year. And that gave us a big publicity, and there were enormous inquiries, and some media channels also, they came to us and they shot all this innovation. They helped to raise this invention to a higher scale.
Thank you, sir. So, I mean, as he was telling me earlier as well, that the innovation primarily came about because of their own need, but the word spread through after. The innovation was recognized by NIF, it was showcased on DD, and suddenly they had their phones ringing throughout the day.
Yeah.
And that's when they decided we need to convert it into an enterprise itself. I'll go to Shailaja ma'am now. She also, like we saw, you know, here as well, in a very informal way, there was a partnership between an innovator and an engineer and a manufacturer happening too, which helped scale the technology further. And Shailaja ma'am has been, again, working with a lot of innovators to help them scale, actually identifying the right technology, customizing it for the local regions that she's working in, and helping them scale from there on. So there are loads of innovators and young entrepreneurs here. Could you share two or three main learnings from your experience so far on how what it takes for an enterprise like yours, Dharma Technology, to actually sustain? Could you elaborate on
that? Yeah, sure. Thank you. My journey started about 14 years back. That time I was in IIT Guwahati. My husband was working for GAN Northeast, working for towards grassroots level innovators, helping them. So during that time, I was in contact with many innovators of Northeast. It was very interesting, and but always one thing was haunting, I should say. You know why innovators cannot be a successful entrepreneur? So then I came across one gentleman. He's an innovator. He was innovating, mid of Areca dehusking machine. He was stuck in between, but technology-wise as well as the monetary. When he came to my husband for technology help, he helped him, but he needed some money. Then that moment, my plan was to help this innovator. I didn't want to become an entrepreneur. My pure intention was to help this innovator. And being from Karnataka, I found the similarity of Areca dehusking machine. The problem was the same in whether it is Guwahati or Karnataka. I wanted to become a bridge of these two states, manufacturer helping the innovator to develop the machine and make it farmers acceptable, and then bring those machines to help the farmers. I wanted to help my own people, my farmers. Thinking like that, I helped him. But that innovator couldn't, he stuck in between. So that was a situation where I wanted to become an entrepreneur myself. So my husband said, if you want to continue with this, because already taken the responsibility of bringing one technology, you take it as a challenge, could you make it and prove yourself, your innovation and entrepreneurship can be a successful innovator. If you, whatever the ideas he think that can bring to the market, make it market viable. So about 14 years that took it as a challenge, and I came to Karnataka, Tumkuru, and said this Dharma technology. So in the process of making this Harka de-husking machine, I came to know that the jury, woman. So whenever we think about the farmers, any while working in the field, that jury is a main thing. So whenever we have to think about making any, developing any machines or equipment, keeping the drudgery and the woman in mind, we have to develop a machine. It should be simple. So the main concept of Dharma technology, whenever we design, so the designs are very simple and farmer friendly. So they should able to understand, and they should able to service those machines on their own without depending on our service from the whom they have purchased. So Harka de-husking machine while developing, so few farmers came and they asked us, why can't we develop some technology for Gorbalu polisher? So Gorbalu polisher was the first machine which we developed and released to the market, because the value addition was very high. Whatever the Gorbalu polisher they used to get, if they sell it as it is, was only 2500 rupees. But once they developed it, when they processed and if it is sold, they would get 25,000 as a premium price. So that mission was very successful, and it was very much appreciated by the farmer, and the value addition was too high. So when that gave me that success up till today, we have around 40 technology we have developed in the past 14 years. But the satisfaction what we got from this, especially this Gorbalu polisher, the success till today is too much. In 14 years, I might have sold about 140 or 150 machines all over Karnataka. But there are more than 20 to 25,000 machines are there around Karnataka, because it is copied in such a way that, because it's very simple and value addition is more, and farmers can get more value for whatever they have grown. So that appealed them more. So since then, it was the beginning, and since then we learned, so what actually the farmers need, and that they gave me moral boosting also, so okay, I can continue so successful after this. Then we moved on to other machines. Then in the main thing, I started as an entrepreneur, but as the days goes on, main motto was to help other innovators. Whenever there is a requirement for them, any technical guidance that we do, and then we incubate also. Incubation in the sense for the students, because students, when they do their projects, they will come with very lot of ideas, but they do not get places where they can get it done or get proper mentoring. So we, Dharma Technology, we do that also. So their two successful incubation has been done, two technology. One is Vadiraja Stove. So that is for any dry waste. So energy efficiency is high, and that is there in the market. And Upper Krishna project, they use for all their laborers to give, and so many organizations they have used the Vadiraja stove. And for Varaha, it is a kitchen waste to compost. It is also again incubated for the student level, and it's very good. It is appreciated, and it doesn't give any smell, and it goes with the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. I think Dharma technology is working in these, balancing all these. Yeah. And as an entrepreneur, you asked how I have sustained.
Yeah, the other thing, especially you were saying earlier that how when you're looking at agri technologies, you know, diversification is really important.
So for any innovator or entrepreneur to become sustainable means they cannot stick to one product. Suppose if I take my Harka de-husking machine, suppose if a farmer purchase one Harka de-husking machine, the work is only for 3 months. So then next 9 months, even I will not have any customer, and he will also think before buying, if I have to spend 1 lakh rupee on the machine, so only for 3 months, what about another 9 months? So then we thought, Arakan at along with Arakan at this pepper and coffee also they grow. Why not we give them the multi-purpose processing machine, because we develop agriculture or horticulture processing machine. Why can't we incorporate with the same machine, with the minimal changes of changing the blades, something like that. He can use the machine at least to process these three products, whatever he grows. So that we could able to succeed, and that is where even farmers are very happy that whatever the machine they purchase from us, they can utilize at least for 9 months a year. So their money will not be go waste only for 3 months. 9 months at least they can utilize the same machine for the different purposes. And it's very, the design is very simple, farmer friendly, and servicing is not at all there.
So Narayan, you also have been working on agri processing machinery specifically, and in your sort of problem assessment itself, you really looked at energy aspect as well, or energy scenario really guided your innovation process. Could you expand on how Big Stamp has been looking at that?
Okay, can I stand up? Yeah, so that I can see all of you guys. And I'll start off with, everybody likes a story, right? Stories, okay? And it's not going to take much time. I got the clock on my head, okay? So three stories, okay? This is year 2008, and I graduated in 2003 as a mechanical guy, happy-go-lucky guy, big bikes, riding hard. 2008, I meet one of my mad friends, okay, Dinesh and Aditya, two mad friends. And Dinesh comes to me and says, hey, they're my teammates, by the way. I can call him mad, you can call him too, okay? The thing is, he said, Narayan, millets are good, millets are good, millets are good. Let us eat it, let us eat it, let us eat it. Okay, I hear him first. And second time he comes back and says, Narayan, millets are good, millets are good, let's eat it. I said, where are the millets to eat, man? There's no millets, everybody is feeding the birds. I said, if you want to sell millets, let us first make two things. Let us make it viable for the farmers to grow it. Second, process it and give it to the people. So are you ready to put up a factory? Next day he was with a form saying, I'm going to put up a factory to sell millets. Okay. Now I said, how are you going to raise the funds? He said, friends, families and fools. Okay, so I was one of the fools, okay? And trust me, in 2015, with 30 members, women members, Earth360 is his company, I'm part of it too. We have a successful, operationally profitable company with zero investors. With zero investors, bootstrapped completely, crying our heart out, operationally profitable from past 3 years. So 2016, again, I did the mistake of asking Dinesh, now what? We are operationally profitable, what do you want to do? He said, Narayan, this is a community level processing machine which is operationally profitable. Can we make it scalable pan-India? I had to ask this question. Then he said, I said, who's going to make these machines, man? And he said, Narayan, you're an engineer. You have been talking about all this. I used to work for TVS, by the way. He said, you're talking about all these hi-fi machines. Can you make this millet processing machine which is highly efficient and highly robust? And at a price point of 8 lakhs, I'm saying 8 lakhs, remember this point, 8 lakhs, a millet processing machine which is capable of doing 1 ton per day is economically viable, socially viable, and it is a community-driven approach. Remember this. And this is the same model with which Earth360 is working. If you guys want to visit, visit. It's in Kadri. It's running from past 8 years with 3 years operational profitability. Okay. So again, we start designing these machines, and I'm a happy-go-lucky mechanical engineer. Designing these machines, I come up with this amazing 1 HP grader machine. I asked him, which is the first machine you want to build? He said, farm gate grader. Why farm gate grader? Because whenever a farmer makes millets or produces millets, what actually happens is he can command a price of 20 kgs per produce if harvested. If he cleans it and grades it, he'll get 25 rupees. So I want to first give him a higher return, not by paying him higher, but giving him the right value addition. Fair, right? It's fair. You just don't want to give money. For a better validation, you need to give money. So as soon as he said that, I said, okay, let's design this machine. The grader, we started building it. 1 year up, we built, and we have an amazing machine, okay? The three main salients are, it is super reliable, mobile, does 1 ton per hour, really cool, okay? Now the third story. So we are really happy with this machine, and I'm happy, I'm boasting to everybody. And I meet Mr. Thomas, sir. Okay, and I meet Mr. Shingle. And I talked to Thomas and Shingle and say, hey, we have got this amazing machine which is processing millets. It can do really high tonnage. It's really robust. Then he says, can we solar enable it? And I'm happy. I'm saying, okay, yeah, let us do solar enablement. Okay. Then I send my spec sheets to them. I say it's 1 HP machine. And Shingle looks at it and puts a price point of 1.5 lakhs for solar enablement. Oh, man. No, this is not economically viable at all, right?
you're building a machine for community level processing, it needs to be efficient. It needs to be efficient, okay? Now that's when we got our thinking cap on. We don't have Peter Barkos over here, he's always shy. He's a technologist, he's out there with the machine. So when we started thinking about how do we make it energy efficient, we all are engineers over here. Who are not engineers, raise your hand. Okay, you're all engineers too, because we are going to solve a problem together, right? Okay, so the thing is, what is 1 ton? Hey, somebody has to respond, otherwise 1000 kgs. 1 ton processing machine is how much? 1 by 3600 seconds, correct? 1 ton per hour means 1000 kgs by 3600. That means 300 grams per second, am I right? 300 grams per second. 300 grams, do you require 1 horsepower? 1 horsepower means you're using 1 horse to move that 300 grams. No brainer, right? I was an engineer. Until unless these both showed me the economic value and the efficiency, I never knew that. I thought one horsepower is very little power. So honestly speaking, today energy efficient machines are not being built because there's a lot of vulgarity with power. That means to say, we don't know what power actually means. So that's when we thought, we set a target to ourselves. We said we need to build really efficient machine, which is about 180 watts. That's the price point at which the solar enablement and the price of the machine works fine. You're getting the whole idea? So that's the target we set to ourselves. Now, a grader machine is nothing but which shakes the grains and makes it sieve, makes it cleaner. Who has seen such thing, such a operation? Yeah. Anything similar you have seen in your life? Any similar operation, not for grading, but shaking it, shaking operation, which is it? No, when we are born, all our parents put on a cradle, right? How heavy is the baby? 2 kgs, right? 2 to 3 kgs. And you're able to shake it continuously for hours together, right? Correct? Is it 1 HP power? So that's when the whole design inspiration came in, and we created something called as an inverted cradle mechanism. And as soon as we put the inverted cradle mechanism, if you want to see the inverted cradle mechanism, please walk down the aisle. The 1 HP machine started becoming only 180 watts. Okay? Guys, engineers can design highly efficient machine. It's just that we have been vulgar about power. Everybody is coming more and more powerful machine. So we don't know the context of power. But if you put a power target to us, yes, we can achieve it. Yeah? So again, coming to the point, we got a 180 watt machines. Okay? Now, Shingle, are you happy?
Yeah.
Thomas, sir, you must be also happy. But the thing is, he spoke about PMDC motor, right? We use PMDC motor for our DC enablement. Now we have figured out the next biggest issue, which is consuming a huge power, is our gearbox. It's eating up about 80 watts. And we are looking towards something called as e-bike technology. E-bike technology, they have got a special motor in them, which is much more efficient at a lower price point. With that, we are doing our testing. It's 120 watts. My three stories are over, and I'm going to sit back, and if there is any questions, you can bump it off.
Thank you so much, Narayan. I'm going to pass the mic maybe to Kartik now. So yeah, as we saw in, you know, his case, Narayan's case, and Big Stam's case, in energy efficiency, they think, and I hope you all think as well, that plays a huge role in terms of increasing accessibility. But it also obviously requires, for him to now grow the enterprise, for him to even come up with the innovation, it requires a different kind of benchmarking from the incubation side also. I'm now speaking to the two incubators here, right? On how do you actually help the entrepreneurs think that way, because that helps them increase affordability for their end users also. So when you're looking now at Sangam Ventures, which is purely focused on, you know, incubating the energy side of the ecosystem, so how do you now create this kind of a program or mentorship which can specially advise all these enterprises here, especially from the energy side of it?
Sure, I'll stick with energy. I got the message. So two parts to it, right? So from an incubation and acceleration perspective, I think the main focus for us at Sangam Ventures is basically the same as what it is at like Social Alpha or at Selco, right? Which is first the focus on the customer and kind of making sure that you can immerse yourself in the customer. If the entrepreneurs are more innovators or more biased towards technology, then somebody from the team will spend the time give, you know, building that empathy for them, right? And and I think you have to do it, like, and we have to teach the entrepreneurs to do it if they want to move from innovators to entrepreneurs. I think customers are the difference between the two, right? And then the second part is around product development, and there were really great, interesting examples around around, you know, your transition and pathways to product development, right? Like how Kusumdhara sir talked about, you know, going towards something mechanical first. So, you know, kind of we talk about like prototyping, you know, first few levels of a product till you kind of let it evolve to what makes the most sense for a customer from a servicing capability, a bunch of other things, right? So product development and assisting with product development as it relates to the customer is important. But I also want to go to what Shubhoday said. I think I want to invite you to our next investment committee meeting because I think you made a very good case for what you're trying to do. So we are on that level a bit of a ugly duckling of maybe impact or energy investing. We dig in and then we kind of find that one problem that seems to be the barrier, and then seeing if we can kind of fix for that, right? So an example of that is a company called Inficold that we invested in, where we did thermal storage batteries and used the cheapest PCM, which is water, to provide the solution, but also kind of drove the entrepreneur and the team. It's not like, you know, cracking the whip, but, you know, spend the time with them, but they've basically gotten to a point where they are really excited in bringing that technology to be something mass market, as accessible and as affordable as possible. But to what Shubhoday was talking about, for our next investment, what we are considering is actually a couple of ISRO, ex-ISRO engineers who are only specifically working on heavy powertrains, right? So specifically bringing that technology, they are building it for you know, kind of all kinds of commercial purposes, but they're extremely open to picking up problems and driving it, right? So for us, because we sit behind, we are not the entrepreneurs, we are surely not the innovators, we sit behind, we kind of can take the portfolio approach of building a community of innovators and entrepreneurs who can actually be better than just who they are by themselves.
Is it hard to find like mentorship which is able to bring that the whole combination, right? Or even to identify what kind of exact mentorship does?
So I think to me, the whole the more time we have spent in the ecosystem, the mentorship concept is just a little bit off, right? So we don't think in terms of mentorship, because mentorship sometimes kind of creates this, you know, top-down approach of telling somebody what to do. What we want is basically a really good, amazing set of peers. And others in the ecosystem who want to participate, right? So if there is some level of participation, that will be great, but also kind of differential, you know, approaches, you know, differential thoughts on how to build stuff, and also different people with different, you know, kind of, I think Ramanan spoke about it, like, you know, bring people from the liberal arts into it, like, you know, not everybody needs to be an engineer in the room, you know, you need some other creatives to actually build new technologies and bring new innovations.
So, I mean, one is the incubation side of it, but of course, like, there's a huge aspect of, we saw all these three entrepreneur stories, two, if I may say, fairly mature than Big Stan currently. But all of them have bootstrapped it so far. All of them have looked at kind of growing it slowly through their own, either investing their own monies or investing back whatever their profits have been. But also at the same time, we know about the impact that all of their innovations are creating. So in that sense, Smita, if you could throw some light in terms of when you were, with your experience in the sector, do you think there is actually enough failure monies? Because obviously, you know, we need that as well for things like this to come up. And obviously this takes some kind of patience as well, because you're looking at enterprises who are trying to deliver in an ecosystem which is not developed yet. So how is your what is your sense of the sector in that sense?
No, thank you. Thanks, Rachita. And I think a lot of the challenges and the kind of solutions that are either there or need to be done, I think Shobhita has very nicely hit the nail on the head and many times over. And then examples you've seen. And I think what is needed is exactly the three examples that we heard about, just multiplication of these. And I must say, Narayan, everything that happened to you happened in the right sequence. And breaking down of the problem in terms of first solving it and then making it efficient and then making it affordable and therefore trying to do it in the right sequence is probably what's needed in more cases. Sometimes, I don't know, whether as pressures from, say, investors or funders or as trying to do everything at the same time or being ambitious, we try and do a lot of things at the same time and the whole the piece of the puzzle that needs to be solved first probably sometimes comes in the end, right? So I think that is one critical part. In terms of, yes, there is a need for patient capital and a higher risk appetite, as we keep saying, because we are talking about not a typical conventional impact investment scenario here. We are not talking about money that was meant for multiplying and doubling up. This is money that's coming from philanthropy. And Social Alpha is supported by Tata Trust, and that's where our genesis is. And many other incubators are supported and funded by the government or various other sources of philanthropy. And I think that money, realizing that money is meant for solving these problems, whether it's going in a grant mode or an equity mode or an incubation or investment style, the idea is to solve that problem and not look at a quick ROI or not look at the most promising and strongly easily scalable business models, because that's what has other sources of money available as well. So yes, investment or incubation or any kind of piloting support needs to come in at the right time. The way we are well placed, fortunately, to look at some of this, and these are the pain points that we've recognized and we are working on, and we are continuing to work in our own humble way on that, is essentially the fact that support from Tata Trust, one, means access to philanthropic capital, which is across themes, which is anyway building on the years of experience of the trust. Secondly, there are there's a deeper understanding of some of these problem statements, and a lot of our initiatives came from working on one thing and then realizing the problem that we faced there wasn't a solution to, and they went hand in hand, and then working on the second problem. But more than that, even having implementation arms and execution arms, because you have ideas, you come up with technology, but that for an entrepreneur straight out of the lab to go and pilot that technology with no community support or no grassroots support and then start from mobilizing community and then taking it forward. And I see entrepreneurs here who've done that, who've had their stories of struggle and there for a long time to reach where they have. I think that is taxing, and that is expecting too much from the entrepreneur. We expect them to wear or they're required to wear too many hats and know all of this together. So I think having that kind of a setup already, the stage already set, and then plugging those innovations in, bringing in our own understanding of impacts or indicators and seeing what could be done better, not from an evaluation perspective and just saying this works better than that, because unfortunately we're not at that stage. We don't have several solutions to every problem statement. We'll get there. We'll get to that kind of critical evaluation when we are there. Right now, what is probably needed is looking at it from a introspective and mutual learning point of view and saying this worked, but exactly how Narayan saying, how do we now do this bit? And mentors like Thomas and people like this whole mentorship question, not identifying typical persona of a mentor, but saying a coach, a confidant, a visionary who's constantly pushing, but also somebody who's like constantly working with you almost as a co-founder, right? And be playing the devil's advocate, the right friends, so to say, to drive you. So I think all of that is needed. At Social Alpha, what we're trying to do is we've set up a clean energy incubator, which is looking at all kinds of technologies. And like you were saying, Shubhadev, we do see the need for launching a challenge like that. And we ran it last year, and I'll be announcing that shortly here as well. A challenge for bringing innovators to the space, because are we expecting too much from manufacturers as well? Are we expecting manufacturers to innovate? Why are innovators or engineers not getting drawn to the productive appliances for livelihood and clean energy inclusion into it, that space? Why are and how do we run challenges, and how do we have criteria that sort of pulls out and scouts for these kinds of innovators? we also realize what Shailaja ji was saying, that an innovator may not be wanting to be an entrepreneur, and an innovator will not be wanting to be a manufacturer more often than not. And instead of situation pushing them into that, we are looking at setting up, you know, and we are working on areas such as design for manufacturing. So how do we bring in more manufacturers, more designers, and in the absence of market insights on these kind of products? Because it's not that the solution is not available, even that product category does not exist in many cases, and you know, the understanding of what could be done here is missing in several cases. And so in that kind of a situation where you don't know whether to put the cart first or the horse first, getting designers, design for manufacturers, product designers, and you know, every incubation support to sort of look at that is extremely, extremely critical. Then looking at matching entrepreneurs with innovators. So we're running a program called E4I, Entrepreneurs for Impact, where we're trying to do is scout for innovations that wouldn't go beyond the lab if there weren't right entrepreneurs to take it to the market. So how do you map the right set there? So essentially some of these things, and the other thing I'd say is what we are now going to be increasingly trying to do is a clustered approach to replicate these templates. So you get these innovations, you get these solutions, and they've worked in a certain area. The kind of work that CEW has done at micro level that you referred to, or Selco and Terry have done at capturing the market, I think that is where we all need to step in. Whoever is working in this space and trying to be a facilitator needs to step into at a micro level to do some assessments of markets, to encourage innovators as well as manufacturers to enter the space, you know, in a commercial, with a commercial hat, and not just forced by grant. But some of the early stage, livelihoods, appliances that are at a stage where we are trying to even see a fit, a product market fit, I think there is grant funding and very, very, very patient investment if it is coming in the form of investment to begin with.
It's good to know. So we have questions already. So maybe can we take maybe two or three at a go and then have our panelists respond to them? There's one, there are two there.
Hi, I'm Shambhavi from IKEA Foundation, and I have a question for Kusundara, sir. While you were developing your milking machine, did you think about the compassion footprint? Or let me put it differently, you were using different motors and pumps and stuff on the udders of a cow. Did you think about animal welfare? Because when we look at innovation, we usually just focus on the users, but then what about the compassion footprint? And especially when you look at efficient manufacturing, efficient appliances, do you really think about the other aspects, especially when it comes to animals? Because happy animals lead to quality produce.
Take two more questions, sir.
Hi, Abhishek from CEW. I just want to take a couple of minutes I know we don't have a lot of time, but so a couple of comments and one question towards the end. One, I think just wanted to correct the number. So the market potential is actually more than $50 billion, not five, just to sort of put that into the context. The second thing was that I think one of the things which I think Shailaja ma'am brought in, but we sort of didn't dwell on the point a whole lot, that there are multiple innovations required for an entrepreneur to actually sustain in this space. A lot of the innovations that we are talking about, let's say these polishers or silk reelers and so on, there is market, there is scattered market, but not a market which is at a significant scale. So if an entrepreneur is thinking that, okay, I'm doing one innovation and then probably I'm going to sort of run that business for 10 or 15 years based on that one innovation, that's probably not going to happen in the space in which we are. So what we need actually, a lot of innovators developing multiple innovations, but then a few entrepreneurs taking those multiple innovations together and bringing it to the markets. So instead of thinking like each innovator or each innovation is going to scale up into a sustainable business, probably not going to happen, especially because you need after sales services which can work across innovations rather than for each innovation you start to create models. That's one point I wanted to make. And related to that, the question with which I wanted to end my comment, that I think in the examples that we saw, like whether it was on the milking machine side or whether it was on the millet processing side, there was someone who actually guided like what is it that is needed from an end user perspective. Even on the Potter case, we saw that. Where is it that the value addition can happen, which is going to make an economic sense for the end user? Most often than not, those ideas are not visible to potential innovators. All the engineers sitting in, whether it is regional schools, whether it is ITIs, or whether it is IITs, most often than not, engineers don't know what is the problem they want to they can solve. It's only these sort of people, whether it is the end user themselves or people working with the end user, who are able to bring in these ideas to the potential innovators. I think that we need to create a systematic way in which we can document these needs. I mean, we have tried to do a sort of 30,000 feet view analysis that, okay, what are the areas in which things are required? But I think if we can figure out a way, I mean, if panel can throw some light on it, sure. Right, what could be the ways to sure. gather that value addition needs? Yeah, thanks.
From Ecosyn. So I'm taking a view from what Shubhodaya was mentioning regarding lower hanging fruit with respect to highly energy efficient motors or systems. So one thing which was, I feel there was a gap was, I mean, it may not be necessary when we go for highly efficient stuffs, it will be cost effective also compared to the earlier systems. So how do we incentivize people like us, or maybe in rural area, anyone it is, to buy the more efficient product? Because an example I can tell you is that the pumps which we use in irrigation. So there are a lot of AC pumps which are already there in use, which is not at all efficient. So like the way you said, PMSM is a very extremely efficient compared to the AC one. So, but it is costly also. So farmers, it's not, if you go to a farmer and ask him to buy, I doubt whether he will buy it. So that, I just wanted your opinion. And so just one point which I got from Abhishek, I would just like to say, the last point which he said about innovators may not be knowing about the requirement. I think there are few platforms like knowledge sourcing, you can say, which are currently, I don't know the exact names of the platforms. There are a lot of platforms which are there where people will come and post their requirements. So if there are innovators and engineers and who can bring solution to it, they can work towards it, and those people pay or crowdsource and all those things. So that is one idea which I could just say. Thank you.
Madam was asking about the animal welfare, how the cow was having, what was its feeling, whether it was liking it, whether it was like suckling of the calf. Yes, it was. It is like suckling of the calf. We have developed that process. Whenever the machine is adapted, it will give a massage onto the teats, and we are not pumping milk. Animal, unless it drains the milk, we cannot milk it. It is a biological process. Whenever we put the machine, we start the machine, it will give a pulsing action. Like it's similar to the suckling action of cow. We have taken care of that during the design itself. And the better part is, the machine was designed for manufacturing purpose, as Madam was telling. The innovator has got the support to take it forward by the way of designed for manufacturing. If we are not designing the idea for manufacturing purpose, then if there is no total engineering on that, it is not sustainable. You can have, I can show you the feeling on that machine itself.
We have
you can
demo
put your thumb, you can see a demonstration.
Yeah. So, yes, both of you maybe.
I think for Abhishek's question, I think I can answer. You said how an innovator will be knowing what the people they want, how they can, what are the problems are there to be solved. See, in my experience, I can tell when I started with Arakadiha's Green Machine. So there were so many ideas were there, but we don't know which one to start. But once if we develop a technology, if it is accepted in the market or with any group like farmers or with whom we are catering, I think later on people will start coming. Once they get confidence in you, we don't have to go to them. They themselves come to us. So in my experience, every month at least 5 to 6 problem comes to us, to Dharma Technologies. So in out of that, that is how we could able to, we are not stick to one particular technology. In this span, we might have thought about more than 100 but we could able to bring 40 plus, and around 2025 it is into the production, and fewer turnkey projects. I think innovator need not be worried about the problem. Only the first few they have to. Once their capability is known and the design, like in dermatology, what we do, ours is a parasitic design. So we do not manufacture our own components. We rely on tested components like bearing or shaft, which are already proven tested. And this is very simple, so that customer who are end user, they feel it is very hassle-free machine. Once they come to know that, then I think certainly word of mouth or having confidence in whoever has developed that machine, they themselves come with attracted towards the whoever the manufacturer innovator, and innovator will come to know what he has to innovate, what should be his next problem-solving machine.
Could I just add to it? Just 1 minute, guys. So Abhishek, I totally understand the issue that you're not seeing what to innovate. Let me give you a small eye-opener. We want aspirators for our grader. Can you innovate it for us? And I'm not going to ask it for free. Come down on stake. We are ready. Come down. Work with us. The issue what you're facing, we face it too, because we don't get good engineers. Nobody has sex appeal in working for Agritech. Let me be very honest. You go to Ford, you go to Chrysler, people want to work over there. You would say Agritech, it is in Kadri. We have got about 5 engineers who come by, they look at the whole thing, they go back. Okay. So your problem is solved. We have got a problem innovation for you. Please come down, design our aspirator. I'm not asking for free, it's on stake. Come down, join our company. No two questions asked. Second question, you had told about the BLDC motor, right? Where it's pretty costly. I would like to appreciate Harish Chandi sir over here and the entire Selco team. They made, their company was not about solar innovation, it's about end mile connectivity, right? Getting the solar to the right people. So there are right economic models by which you can reach it to the people. And that is the same model which we are also looking forward for our, from our millet machines and tool, because when you establish a 8 lakh worth processing unit, nobody is going to give money, not the banks, right? Collateral free loan, nobody is going to give. But it's a sustainable model, proven model. So Selco-like companies are there who can help in this sort of tricky issues where it is not about technology passing, but it is about end mile connectivity of the technology via right business model. Am I clear on that? Yeah. Or if it was confusing, I'm sorry.
Okay. So thank you so much all for being patient with all of us.
Let me just answer his question.
Sure, but maybe just
quickly.
3 minutes, yeah. Okay.
So if I understand your question right, your question was, you know, these advanced technologies, energy efficient technologies, typically cost more than the incumbents like induction motor. And yes, I'm not disagreeing with that. Today, BLDC motors cost 50 to 100% more than an induction motor or a PMDC motor. That's true. But it's been true with all technological innovations like LEDs, you take LEDs, you take, you know, EV batteries, everything. Okay. So one important thing to bring this cost down is there will always be a cost premium for an efficient technology compared to an inefficient technology. That cost premium will always be there. But one way to bring this bridge back down is the scale again, the economies of scale. Another important way is indigenization of the basic components. That is also important. So if you see today BLDC motors, the permanent magnets, the advancement has happened because of rare earth alloys. Okay, so earlier it was only ferrite magnets. Now there are some alloys, rare earth alloys mixed with ferrite magnets, neodymium magnets and all. So this advancement has led to the increased flux density, magnetic flux density in magnets, and they've been able to use. But these are rare earth elements. Okay, but with more scale, and recently it's been, you know, some mines have been discovered, with more scale and indigenization, these elements and imported elements such as control systems, these electronic speed controllers, if they are indigenized within the country, you can certainly bring down the cost. So that's why I'm stating that innovation is needed from engineers, from academia, from, you know, manufacturers. This collaborative innovation is required to indigenize these components and bring down the cost. This is one way. To touch upon the solar pumping ecosystem, like you mentioned, yes. Today, if you see MNRE standards, despite knowing solar DC pump set, that is the BLDC pump set, is much more efficient, still, you know, MNRE standard still has a brushed option, a brushed DC motor option, and an AC induction motor option, even though they're less inefficient than a DC pump set option. There are reasons for MNREs, because the ecosystem, some of them believe that the AC pump set's maintenance is very easy because you know, they're rugged in construction. There is a well-established ecosystem for maintaining AC pump sets. And for BLDC pump sets, it's not. But, you know, some myths are also there because BLDC pump sets, they don't need really maintenance. They're electronically communicated. And apart from the controller, there is not much of maintenance requirement. Okay, so some of these myths have to be also, you know.
Thank you so much again. Thank you, Shubhadev, for that. So for me, the main takeaway, I think we named it the panel like that as well. The need-based is kind of the key here. I mean, all of our panelists from the incubation side who are trying to create those kind of partnerships who are able to get the different kind of expertise that helps you understand what exactly is the value add of the technology. And of course, the way that our entrepreneurs here as well have been working with both the innovation side, the engineering side, as well as the end user. Of course, we can always question where are the problems, but I feel if you go and speak to everyone outside who's doing a demo, there are problems everywhere. Ranjanji in the morning said that, you know, yes, I have, I have a puffed rice maker, but then I need a dryer next. So I think it's just about a conversation that we need to have with different people, and we would realize that there is really a huge scope and huge need here. So thank you so much to all our panelists. And if we could have our colleagues, please, just a little token of our appreciation. A big round of applause, please. I know we have lunch next, but just a bit more energy on the applause.
Before we head for lunch, there's an announcement. So we'd like to call upon Smita Rakesh from Social Alpha to launch Social Alpha Energy Challenge.
Hello, sorry I'm back again, but I'll not take much of your time. Could we have the presentation, please? So we're back with the second edition of the Social Alpha Energy Challenge, which I, slightly hinted about in the panel. The challenge is something we'd run last year, and we had picked up 11 winners from innovative and impactful energy technologies. One of them, SolShare, is here, so you'll interact with Sebastian and Neil from there. The challenge opens today, and it follows essentially the philosophy of Social Alpha and Tata Trust, which says we imagine an India where entrepreneurs and innovators have access to all resources. So the idea is that the selected winners will win all kinds of customized, tailor-made incubation support and possible investment support based on successful completion of milestones once they are selected. We are looking for technologies across a whole range of sectors and use cases, as you can see, any stage of the energy life cycle. And the underlying theme is actually affordability, accessibility, and user experience, something we just spoke about right now. 2 months of application starts today, so I'd request everyone to spread the word, and please apply if you're an innovator or are willing to partner with an innovator and apply. So that's mostly it. For more details, you could visit socialalphachallenge.org/energy, and there's a 1-minute video that I'd request you to play, please. Thank you.